Hi guys, it's Ruth from Property Sisters here. We've got the lovely Michelle Dean from Peritus Finance, Peritus Corporate Finance. So we're going to be talking today about commercial lending. We are, what date is it today? It's the 25th of August 2020. So, and we've obviously had a bit of a rocky road in the commercial market over the last 6 months. So how is it going at the moment, Michelle?
Yeah, it's it has been very rocky, and things have been a lot worse than they are now. Lenders are coming back in the market. They are, although they're cautious, we have got lenders that have gone back to say 75% on portfolio buy to lets, on commercial. Probably we're looking at somewhere between 65-70%. We're not back to pre-COVID, but we're definitely a little bit more flexible than kind of 2 or 3 months ago, when lenders were that they just weren't interested in taking any kind of risk. Like 50% was the maximum they'd like to be at, and but they would charge you the earth for that. And now we've got more lenders coming back in the market, and actually wanting to do business, which is really nice to see. Being quite flexible and changing their policy if they need to. So we've had a couple of deals where we're looking to lend on a large portfolio of properties that are finished in a development, going on to a term loan. And there's a lot of lenders out there that would do that on a block policy basis. So the value would be on a block sale basis, which is sometimes up to 15% below the value of the open market value. And we've actually got the lender to change their mind and do it against the open market value because of the market at the moment, because things are improving in the residential market.
I mean, so that's the residential market's going nuts, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Parody of the whole thing, which I can't quite get my head around.
Well, I think there's a couple of reasons for that. And I think the stamp duty, the fact that stamp duty has been reduced or stopped completely in some instances, has really helped a huge amount of people. And I think that people think it's a really good time to do something right now. However, on the flip side of that, I think that once furlough is finished and people are made redundant or, you know, don't have a job anymore, I think then we will see the real problems that are going to occur from what's happened in the last 4 or 5 months. And I think that the buoyant housing market we've got currently, I can't see it continuing in its current form for much longer. I mean,
we have in the UK is we have like a supply and demand issue that underpins everything here. So we're not like America, where, you know, obviously prices are going to tumble because there's so much property. But here we always have this supply and demand issue, don't we, which kind of makes things just a little bit quirky.
Absolutely. I mean, let's face it, people always want to, you know, live somewhere, and if it's not rented, it's they want to buy somewhere, and I think that that will obviously continue. My biggest worry in the next kind of 6 months to 12 months is how many people will be able to afford to buy or even rent, because will they even have a job? So
lenders must be really looking at that. They must be digging down to see what kind of industry you're in and the longevity of
if
that.
You've been furloughed, or if you haven't been furloughed, what you're bit. Lots, I think there's lots of additional questions being asked currently of people, which isn't a bad thing at the end of the day. Why take on such a big commitment, which is like one of the biggest commitments you'll ever take on, by buying a house, or in fact by signing up to rent somewhere for 6 months, if your job isn't secure? If you know that deep down next month or the month after, you may not be in a job. I think, you know, lenders have to be quite cautious, but also I think just the general public do as well, and not rush into anything. But commercial wise and development wise, we're still seeing a really good amount of inquiries through from people looking to develop. Looking, there's a lot of owner occupier commercial inquiries coming through at the moment, where people are looking to buy some premises and work from them, either as offices or, you know, more industrial.
Yeah,
and that's quite interesting because I wasn't expecting that at this time of the year. Yeah, but that's quite a good thing that's going on currently.
Well, just to make it clear for our viewers, we are not talking about HMOs because I do get a lot of questions about, oh, but the HMO market is, it, you know, isn't working like that. But we don't classify HMO under commercial. So, you know, we'll talk about that next week with Jake. But yeah, that's just for the viewers, just to point that out. Yeah.
I mean, we do large portfolios of properties, but we don't really do HMOs in the commercial side. But as we said in Peritus Private Finance, they do all the HMO and regulated mortgages.
Yeah, perfect. So, you know, you were talking about how you think the market's going to change when the furlough kicks in about October time. So what are you saying, that people should get in quickly now if they're refinancing or before October, before, or if your job's secure and you're not, you know, you're not going to be affected by furlough, then
if furlough does not affect you, then you can just carry on doing what you're doing. No need to rush into anything, things aren't going to change from the lender's point of view and the products that they're offering, rates and service, etc. But things will change if people start to get made redundant, or if things happen that means that they're not going to have a steady income. So rushing into something when you know things might happen is not a good idea to do. But I really hope that we come out of it as quickly as we went in, basically, and that you know, if what they're saying is correct and all these people are going to get made redundant, I really hope that doesn't happen, because it is going to have quite a big effect on the housing market and the number of people that can get mortgages. I really hope it doesn't happen, but wait and see, watch this space.
Would you feel nervous about buying commercial premises to convert to residential using a bridge and then looking to refinance at the end of that again? You know, that's obviously what me and Gillian look to do, and we're in the process of getting planning at the moment, but we feel nervous about getting a bridge to do the development work and then to be left high and dry without a product at the end.
You will always have a product that I don't think there'll be any issue with the product at the end. And normally you build to rent rather than build to sell. But either way, you know, as I said before, there's people always are looking for somewhere to live. And if you're priced in the right way, which normally you are, and most people are, let's face it, you know, we've got lots of deals where they're really, really big properties, and we've got many that they're really affordable properties. And it's knowing your market and understanding who's going to be available. Nobody can see, you know, if this is 12 months ahead, I don't know what we're going to look like 12 months ahead from now. It's a really hard one to say, you know. We know what things are like right now, but what they're like right now and in 2 months' time, it's going to be completely different again.
It's just like I see a bigger risk for us developers taking on bridges over like a year, 14 months, and then not knowing, because we've all been quite confident about, we know what the end game is going to look like. But now I don't feel confident in, you know, and taking on so much risk to know that I can then refinance at the end.
I think the refinance is not going to be a problem. There are plenty of lenders out there that will do a refinance of, say, 5 or 6 rented properties, ASTs, or, you know, whichever, HMOs, ASTs, whichever. That refinance won't be a problem. I think what will be more of an issue is getting the people in to rent the properties. And that's why I'm saying in the next 12 months, I really don't know what's going to happen. But what I do know is people always want accommodation, always want housing. So, I mean,
you're absolutely right. The market moves so quickly. And if you asked me 2 weeks ago, before the A-level fiasco happened, about the student market, I was like, oh, no, we're gonna, not going to have any students this year. And now they're oversubscribed because of the cock-ups with the government. It's like, oh, my God, now there's not enough accommodation around, you know. So we've gone from, I don't know how lenders feel about student accommodation now, but everything is totally oversubscribed. Because of, you know, too many students now for universities. So a couple of weeks ago, we were hearing rumours in the marketplace that, you know, and people saying that if you're into student accommodation, like we are, that that's a bad place to be. But actually, 2 weeks later, it seems to be a good place to be.
That's how quickly things can change. And I do think that there will always be a market for student accommodation, always, because that we're never going to go a year where universities don't open. I can't see it.
A lot of them will go bust anyway, won't they?
I didn't see any of this happening, so what do I know? But I do think that, you know, student accommodation, it is one of those things that it's always needed. Yes, there are areas of the UK that are oversubscribed for student accommodation. There's far too much for the size of the universities. But you don't do that. You do all of your background checks. You only build where you know it's a good place and it's not oversubscribed. So in that respect, I'd have less of a concern than possibly private resi, you know, just doing it under ASTs. I think if I was going to do something, it probably would be for the student market.
Oh, that's interesting. Lovely. Well, I think that's our 10 minutes up. So have you got anything else to add in before we say our goodbyes?
Only to say that, you know, there are plenty of lenders out there. Rates are pretty much where they were pre-COVID. Service levels on some lenders are absolutely appalling. So it is a case of being very careful who you approach lender-wise, and understanding how long things are going to take. I'd say that we're getting back to some kind of normality, and hopefully when we talk again in a month or so, then I can give you a further update as to how normal things are then.
I know, on the resi, that's a really good point actually, because, you know, what I love about Peritus is they make sure they validate all their lenders. So, you know, you're not getting rogue people pulling deals at the last minute. I mean, we're having problems on the resi buy-to-let side of things at the moment, with lenders not honouring what they said they were going to do. I'll pick that with Jake to see what he can give, tell me about, you know, buy-to-let side of stuff. But, you know, and obviously Michelle has a lot of experience because she worked as a lender beforehand. So she's got the inside knowledge. You know, that's why we like Peritus as well. So I just want to say thank you ever so much, Michelle. That was
You're very welcome.
And I'll see you next month.
You will see me next month.
Fantastic.
Great. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.